Obtaining a human body is difficult. Death and impermanence are imminent. Samsara is suffering, but true Dharma is available now. Don't squander your life.
Tell me the truth I want to know. Just where to look and how to go. I need to find true peace. I need to understand. To bring my suffering to an end.
Release the love you hold inside.
Release the love I hold inside.
Just be true and never hide. Behind the face of fear or animosity, you'll break that chain of misery.
How to let go and just be free. The time is now, it's destiny. Surrender.
Let me always forever be.
Let me always forever be.
On one accord, truth and me.
Truth and me.
Abiding in sweet grace, the glow upon my face. Victorious to win the race. How to let go and just be free. The time is now, it's destiny. Surrender now that I have found a way to keep somehow
more than a broken
vow. The noble path.
I walk it every day, and then I realize there's more to life than only bitterness and lies. I close my eyes.
I've found the way, the course that leads to ease. A liberating path, it frees.
I found the way. A course that leads to ease, a liberating path that frees.
I will let go, I'll just be free. The way it's clear, the victory. How to let go now that I've found. Way to keep right now a true unbroken vow. Obtaining a human body is difficult. Death and impermanence are imminent. Samsara is suffering, but true Dharma is available now. Don't squander your life. Yes.
There's a reason.
There's a reason.
Behind your birth.
Behind your birth.
It's not by chance.
It's not by chance.
You're here on earth.
You're here on earth.
Who you are.
Who you are
is how you have been. The law of karma. Nature's love,
nature's love
is perfect and just.
Perfect and just.
If the cause,
the effect is cast.
Though in life,
though in
this pain, this sad human state need not always remain. Break free from this cycle that binds. Leave your ugly, selfish concerns behind. Be a Buddha in your thoughts, deeds, and ways, and surely you'll be in pure land one day.
Look inside your heart.
Look inside your heart.
Your mind be calm and stable too. Break free from this cycle that binds. Leave your earthly selfish concerns behind. Be a Buddha in your thoughts, deeds, and ways, and surely you'll be in pure. Cycle that binds. Leave your earthly selfish concerns behind. Be a Buddha in your thoughts, deeds, and ways, and surely you'll be in pure land one day. And surely you'll be in pure.
So we always talk about, or usually talk about, the Dhamma and Dhamma growth and Dhamma death and progression in terms of lightness, in terms of expanding freedom. And we kind of get the idea that once you get on this path, it's like a cakewalk. But the thing is, we have to remember what we're coming out of, coming out of the dark. And because the whole notion or connotation of darkness can be so frightening to us, we don't want to talk about it because we don't want people to embark upon the path. And so what that means actually is that, let's say that we're in the evening of our life, and that doesn't mean at the end of our life like we're old, but we're at the ripening stage of karma in our life, and it's already uncomfortable. And as we start walking out of it through the grace and the merit of the good karma that is arising, evening is not midnight, is not 2 a.m. So we forget that the darkest hour is just before dawn. And so when we start making our way out, we set an a requirement upon the walking out that every step should be lighter and lighter. But actually, it's the opposite. And if we're not prepared for that, we will either turn around and go and reverse. We'll run away, or we will be disillusioned because we're coming out, but we haven't reached the darkest hour. Because in coming out, there needs to be some fortification so that by the time you get to the darkest hour, you can handle the darkest hour. You see what I'm saying? And so there should be some preparation for us and a non-expectation that once we see the light, that we can directly enter the light, because we have to keep walking until we pass through the darkest hour for the light of dawn to actually manifest in our life. I hope you hear me. I hope you understand what I'm trying to say here. If not, we hold to an unrealistic expectation, and then we miss the emergence. And we miss the emergence simply because we haven't really, really understood the stages of development and what one encounters in the various stages of development. So I thought I'd go over them with you today. It's in the, they can be found, well, they're like 52 stages, but if I tell you about that, that's just too many. People might give up before they get started. So I'll use the condensed version, that's 10 stages. and they're different stages. If you Google 10 stages of development, you'll get some varying, you know, descriptions of what that is and how that is. But from all of that, you can kind of get the main idea, and then you can like chart yours out if you want to. Just know that these things are coming in some at some phase of the process, so that when they come, you're not perplexed. And when they come, you will know that this is part of the process of getting free. And that's the thing that can sustain us when the ugliest parts of our the fruit, you know, that is growing at because of our previous actions, because of our previous choices. When that fruit is rotting on the vine, and we know that the vine is not dead. It's that fruit won't be edible. That we can allow that to drop off and leave the vine uninjured, so that new fruit can grow. Otherwise, we might even chop down the tree, and totally unnecessary. But we thought that because that particular fruit was dead, the vine was also defiled and useless. So the first stage is the stage of joy, in which one rejoices at realizing a partial aspect of the truth. So when we come to the Dhamma, we start learning a few things. We say we start learning a few things about the Dhamma, but actually we start learning a few things about life. We start learning a few things about ourselves. We start learning a few things about other people, not the way, you know, we perceive them, but from a standard of truth, we can see something that is true, whether we want that to be true or not, because of how we feel, or the image that we want to hold about ourselves or someone else. But we start to have a sense of joy because one is actually realizing the truth. You know, you can work with the truth when you realize it. It's just when you don't realize it, you know, that ignorance is bliss. But once one starts to really see the truth, they can begin to hold that truth and begin to figure out how something can be corrected, can be adjusted, can be rooted up, can be planted, can be solidified, you know, can now become flexible and malleable. All of this is learning how to use our own wisdom, but to use our wisdom, we have to be awakened to our wisdom. And so we start to experience some sense of joy because we are waking up to our own wisdom. When you get information, that's just information. But when it reverberates inside of you, then you know that that's your own wisdom rising up to meet that supposition. And internally, you know what that is. And so that sense of joy rises up because of that. The second stage is a stage of freedom from defilement, in which one is free, can be free ultimately of all defilements. The stage of freedom from defilement. The operative word is freedom. In the beginning, the operative word seems to be defilement, because this is not right, that's not right, got to change this, got to fix that, got to, you know, I'm this, I'm that, I'm not doing this, I'm not doing that. And so our focus and our emphasis is on defilement. But you can't stay there, because it's not about defilement, it's about freedom from defilement. You see, so you have to allow the wheel to turn. Even when the Buddha gave the Dhamma, you know, he had these turnings of the wheel And so, but he lay in a foundation, and then he turned the wheel so that you could see the other side. Started with where we are and turned it around to where we can go, where we can be. So the second stage is freedom from defilement. The third stage is the stage of the emission of light, in which one radiates the light of wisdom. And so there's only one way that the wisdom can radiate life, and that is it has to show forth from you. You know the difference when someone is just regurgitating information, you know, versus when someone has some understanding, some realization of what they're talking about, because it bursts forth in such a way that it's impossible to contain it for the one it's bursting forth from, and it's impossible to not catch the flash from the one that it's being imparted to. And so there is this stage of the emission of light, and one begins to radiate the light of wisdom. That's the beginning stage of one knowing one's own wisdom. The next stage of that is the stage of glowing wisdom, in which the flame of wisdom burns away all earthly desires. There, the reason why I'm going through these stages is so that you can like do a personal assessment and kind of see what stage you're in, because it'll give you some hope and some confidence, some assurance, I could say. We might start with hope, and then there's confidence because I can see that. And that confidence brings an assurance, and that assurance brings a kind of neutrality or detachment from the various steps that are involved in the coming out of the darkness. We won't be so focused on every step of coming out of the darkness, because we'll know the trajectory of the release, the trajectory of the freedom. And our eyes will be, where are we on the trajectory of liberation? That shifts our attention. And when our attention shifts, we enter into the energy of wherever we're looking, or wherever we're putting our attention, wherever, you know, we're examining, our energy meets up with that. And so there's the stage of glowing wisdom, in which the flame of wisdom burns away the earthly desires. So I can't put them away. I can't like just let them go. You know, they have to be consumed, and they get consumed by the flame of wisdom. Wisdom does it. You know, so my efforting then is to collapse into the bosom of wisdom and allow those flames of wisdom to burn away the defilements, to burn away all that should not be there. So we're just trying to fix it. We're trying to make it right. With all of our trying, it is not possible. But it is possible via the flames of wisdom. The fifth stage is the stage of overcoming final illusions, in which one surmounts the illusions of darkness or ignorance of the middle way. Okay, so this is a very critical stage. It's a crucial stage. It's a tenuous stage. You have to be careful, this overcoming final illusions, because every time we come out, there's a little bit more light. We can see a little bit more in the room, and so I can see clearly now. So I know what I must do. But we haven't seen clearly because there hasn't been quite enough light in the room. But we think it's enough light because the shadows have turned into figures. But I remember one time when Jesus was healing a blind man, you know, and he put some spit and mud and rubbed together, and he put it on the guy's eyes. And he told him to wash and said, how do you see? He said, I see men walking like trees. He said, not right. And he did it again and had washed and said, now, how do you see? And now the guy could see clearly. So sometimes we think we have come to the absolute clarity of something when we're just at the beginning stages of being able to see. And so we step off in that, you know, step off in it because we have encountered a stage of joy at realizing a partial aspect of truth. You see, we step off because we have, in fact, incurred and realized a stage of freedom from defilements. We step off because there has been an emission of light that's undeniable proceeding from us. We step off because there's a flame of wisdom that begins burning away earthly desires. But maybe everything is not in place that needs to be in place, that when you really get into the fire of the desire realms of life, not quite enough has been burned away. And so one starts to get singed themselves. We step off just because we've stepped out too soon. But with the right motivation, with the right leaning. So the next stage is that, and so we have found ourselves sort of in a middle way, you know, and that's why we're always talking about this being the middle way, but we don't know what the middle way is. Those who talk so much about the middle way is not like this. The middle way is not the muddled way. It's not the mixture of this and this, and you like in the, you know, in the middle, like not hot, not cold, you know, like just right. And that's sort of what we think of as the middle way. Like one aspect is nixing the extremes, but some people are on both extremes. Some people are just on one extreme. That's not an extreme for them if that's where they are. That's where they are. You might take it as an extreme. I might take it as an extreme from where I am. I have on a very big robe today. It's so big that it won't stay up. Sorry, sister. And so we think of rubbing away the edges and the extreme and coming to a middle way. But it's like if I want a cold beverage, I want a cold beverage. If I want a hot one, I want a hot one. If you bring me lukewarm, I don't want it at all, you know? And so and that's also what God said. He said, I'd rather you be hot or cold. He said, but the lukewarm, I spew out of my mouth. Mm-hmm. So we have to get the right understanding or of the middle way, or put away, he calls it putting away the ignorance of the middle way. And when we've done that, then the sixth stage begins to emerge, and that's the stage of the sign of supreme wisdom, in which the supreme wisdom begins to appear. So there is wisdom, but it's not the supreme wisdom. And the supreme wisdom has signs. You have to look for the sign. Now, this is not going to be something that comes up out of one's own mind. I know what to do. I know how to do. I know when to do. I know where to do. I know why to do. I know for whom to do. That's coming from our scattered wisdom, but now we're looking for the signs of supreme wisdom. And the supreme wisdom begins to appear. So we look for the signs, and the supreme wisdom begins to appear. That doesn't sound like I'm doing anything but looking for the signs. And that's where we have to get quiet. It's like leaning not, you know, in all you're getting, get wisdom. But when you get it, don't lean to your own understanding. but allow your path to be directed. And that's so hard when one has been thinking all this time, I've been going in the wrong direction, or I've been going in the right direction, but I'm going around in a loop. I've been confused, but now I have clarity. I'm not confused. And when we start stepping out in that notion, I have clarity, I'm not confused, then that's a sure sign that we have not reached the sixth stage of wisdom yet. Because there's still the who. Yeah, there's still the I. It's just redirected, you know, because I'm surrendered now, you know, because I'm surrendered, and because like I've given up this and given up that and I've discarded this, I'm ready, you know, all of that we say. And then we start stepping out on, so I know now what I'm gonna do. I know what I'm supposed to do. And we start making our plan, and we start putting on the mantle of that new role that we're stepping into, and we end up missing, well, not at the right intersection where the bus is coming by, and so it's we were working today on a retreat we did a few weeks back, and what it's like to begin to emerge from a spiritual bardo. And part of the conversation as people were sharing this morning who attended, like, it was so clear that everybody was in tandem at the first stage and of dropping our masks, you know, just really like getting clear that there's no more time for the, you know, for the euphemisms, for the BS, that, you know, I won't use the word radical because that sounds too radical, but genuine honesty. And it starts with honesty about oneself, you know, and the things that one holds. You can come back if you like, no problem. The things that one holds in their mind and their heart about who they are and what their role is and what their place is, because that has to be given away too. There is the it's not incorrect that there is a unified field. But the unified field is not just opening wide the gates and say, everybody come on in, and then closing the gates and say, we are a unified field. You're only unified if you're unified. You know, it's not that you're all gathering together. And so there has been a piece of the right idea about this coming into a singular kind of spirituality, you know, but it's just not mixing a whole bunch of things. You bring what you got and you bring what you got, and we'll just mix that up and we'll make some alphabet soup or something like that. It's not that, but it's about different ones from all of these different traditions, but they're coming to a place or arriving at a single tone. There's a singular sound. But and everyone hears that one sound. And those that hear that particular one sound gather together from far and near. And that's the kind of true interspirituality that's gonna make a difference, because they're all hearing one sound and all lining up with that one sound, that one frequency, that one vibration, that one understanding of truth. And truth has many different aspects and different layers, but ones who are of a singular sound coming together can bring forth more of that truth than having sour notes and off tones, is what I'm saying. And so everyone who shared today spoke of where they are. And suddenly no one was alone in their journey, because we're all like moving in tandem. And so it was very beautiful for me to hear. And I had made notes, but we ran out of time, but what everybody was saying. And I was listening to the, you know, synopsis of their experience and just trying to write down one word that described, you know, where they were. But the words that were coming were like really seeing myself in a very deep way, you know. Something bursting forth out of me. I don't have to really do anything but show up, you know, and be available. And it's like being able to be used, you know, as a, not an instrument of the universe, because we are the universe, but a portal through which we can help recognize and bring forth a sense of wholeness in others. That healing is a sense of wholeness in others. And so the healing then becomes a byproduct of being tuned and humming the same frequency, the same sound of the whole universe, and then ones hear it, sentient beings hear it, and they are healed. You know, so we're passing the time even of the notion of the healer. And this is so wonderful, because maybe we've tarried too long in some spaces. And maybe we've even gone retro. A lot of things people talk to me about, we did that in the 70s. You know, maybe we've even gone retro. But now there are enough who have said enough of this life. The renunciation is beginning to emerge, the true renunciation. Not like giving up this, giving up that, not that kind of renunciation. But it's like when the things of the world grow strangely dim in the light of this emerging wisdom, you're drawn to the wisdom and you can hardly make out the features of those things that you so cherished and desired. So you haven't really given up anything, you know. And so for some, it was like the surrender. But then the surrender becomes a sweet surrender. And then you realize surrender is all you have to give, because you don't possess anything. And then you realize that it's not even surrendering anything, you know. And then the understanding of surrender begins to turn and shift. And one realizes that one is the inheritor of something rather than the one who's surrendering and giving something. You know, so the sense of giving has gone away. Now one is the inheritor, the recipient of something, ergo the joy in which stages of the 10 stages? They're in the beginning stages of the 10 stages, right? And so that joy starts to come in the beginning stages of the 10 stages. Now, it doesn't mean that the joy goes away, but the joy is the platform. So you can't get to any other stages until you pass through these stages of joy. But joy doesn't seem like you're putting in enough effort, enough work. I mean, when I get to the end and win the prize, I couldn't say, and I did it. You know, you had to have worked harder than others. You had to have been better than others to feel like you have, you know, won something. It's that kind of competition thing that is the opposite of compassion. And it's what drives our ego, even our quest for spiritual things, you know. And so there's this shifting away from the ignorance of the middle way and holding fast to allow the supreme wisdom to begin to appear. So now you're in a waiting pattern. Okay, so you got what not to do. You got a little bit of what to do, but you can't run off and start doing it yet. Now you're in a holding pattern. And if you haven't gone too far and messed things up, then you can pull back and you can hold for a minute, because suddenly it doesn't seem like there's the kind of urgency that you thought was necessary. It's an urgency to get on board. It wasn't an urgency to do something. It's an urgency to get on board so that something could come forward and that you could be used in a peculiar and perfect way. You know, and so there's that. Now we're like so charged up. We're so ready. We don't want to sit down. Now before you couldn't get us up. Then you get, now we don't want to sit down. We don't want to wait. Because we think waiting is waiting, waiting, waiting. But the waiting is more like when you go to a fine restaurant, a white tablecloth restaurant. And the waiter has the cloth over his arm and he stands close to the table. Not so close that he can hear your conversation or you feel like he's invading your space. Not so far away that he can't see when you're the water's going down in your glass, or that it's time to take a plate or a saucer away. He knows the right distance to stand, and he stands there in attentiveness, being attentive to you, but in a way that it doesn't look like he's gawking at you. You know, I mean, finely tuned and finely trained like that. So we have to become a waiter of the highest class and the highest distinction. And that can be difficult once the fire is lit. And that's why it takes the company of good Dharma friends who have taken off their masks, who can speak the truth in love, or who can hold the truth that cannot be uttered yet. So that's the stage, I call it, of the, what you call it, five-star restaurant waiter. And then the next stage is the stage of progress. So the stage of progress comes after the wait, which comes after I know what to do, because we haven't gotten the how yet, which comes after the fire and the brilliance of the wisdom, which comes after the light begins to shine through the darkness, which comes after the stage of freedom from defilements, which comes after the stage of joy, in which one is realizes the partial aspects of truth. So now one can look at what's going on in their life from a different perspective. It's almost like it's inverted, the exact opposite of what we thought. The next stage is the stage of progress, in which one rises above talk of path and vehicles, right? In which one rises above the path of the vehicles, the two vehicles, the Mahayana and Vajrayana. At this stage, there's no more talk about that, you know, because we start to see them merely as methods, you know. They were path when we were on the dirt, but now that we get to this place, that's like being on a dirt road versus getting on the highway. So these things have to drop off. We don't carry everything with us all the way. We carry some things a part of the way, and we set that down to go further. Because as the road gets narrower, you know, the portal gets narrower, a lot of our stuff can't go in there. That was necessary to get you from point A to point B, you know, from point B to point C. But now you're up here at K, you can't take that in. I mean, you don't need it. It's like rowing across the sound and getting to the other side and strapping the boat on your back. It becomes an impediment even, you know. And so the Theravada path and the Mahayana, the Theravada path and the Mahayana path. So when we're attached to and cleaving to, you know, our path, our lineage teachings in that way of grasping and making them concrete, we can't move or we can't proceed to the fineness of, you know, the truth and ultimately to the emptiness of all phenomena. Dhamma is phenomena. So we have to even come to the emptiness of that. Now, if we do it before the natural progression and before one surmounting completes the 10 stages, then we will be deluded. You know. So sometimes somebody will have an experience, they'll have a Satori experience, and it's so profound that this must be enlightenment, you know? And the next thing you know, they're out trying to be a guru, you know? And they did really truly have a profound experience, but they don't know certain things that help them be able to evaluate that. And that's where the grace to have a guide is important. It's useful, and mostly what they do is hold you back. In the beginning, they're pushing you forward, you know. But at some point, you'll notice the relationship starts to change, and they start like holding you back, you know. And that holding you back is really pushing you forward, because it's recognizing the stage and the danger. I mean, that level of the stage is fraught with danger. And so it's really a support and a stabilizing factor. Because one is recognizing your prowess, recognizing your capacity, recognizing your capability, and just saying, but not yet. Because there are a couple of other stages of the path that have to be encountered. So the eighth stage of immobility. In which one dwells firmly in the real truth, the truth of the emptiness of the middle way, and then that one can't be perturbed by anything. And that sense or that feeling of not being able to be perturbed by anything is like coming into the reality of emptiness. And not being perturbed doesn't mean like checking out, like nothing bothers me. I'm not gonna, you know. I mean, a true non-perturbulence, if that's the word. Okay. Not. Imperturbability. I like what was it? That one was pretty good. So, yeah, you got the idea. I mean, like, you know, these things never embarrass me. They tickle me. I mean, people, how do we have our words? People made them up. And so I can make up words, you know. Yeah. And so, I mean, not being perturbed is, it is a state that one arrives in. I read something in Tricycle Magazine and yesterday and early this morning, and the guy was saying, he was on it was good. He was given, you know, it was an article, and he was given a good talk, and then he got to that one little part there when he was talking about not being not being perturbed. And then he said that getting in that state of not being perturbed is not really a state. And he said, and that's where people start vectoring off into some strange fields, you know, because it has nothing to do with state at all. It just has to do with not being attached to anything. And I was like, I sure wouldn't want him to be my teacher, you know, because it was like just cut off from everything. There was no ascension, you know, there was no ascension of the mentality or the mind states. He said, there are no other states, you know, it's just a matter of seeing that as it is, and it is what it is. I wouldn't want to be his student, I wouldn't want to be his wife, I wouldn't want to be his daughter, I wouldn't want to be, you know, because it was just cold and insentient.
Like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like complete detachment. Mm-hmm. And so, and this guy is a professor. You know, he's a professor of Buddhist studies, and teaches at a prestigious university. But I knew he had no cultivated practice at all. Yes.
I'm thinking non-reactive with compassion.
We have this idea that, you know, like you could say non-reactive with compassion, you know, but actually, compassion is reactive. It reacts, you know, it's action. And so we have to, like, be careful of trying to get into what someone has said, like how we should look, you know, like we can handle it. We're not showing any kind of emotion. We're recognizing the thing and we're handling it. But if I had a prize stallion and he got out the corral and he's running and I know there's a precipice right there, I'm not gonna say, come on back. You know? I'm gonna get him, lasso him, yoke him, you know, snatch him back from the jaw of death. You know, so we just have to, like, really be careful that we're not walking around like tin men or plastic soldiers. You could, when we had the store, we had all of these rubber characters, you know, and you wanted them in different fighting stances. You know how the boys do, because they get toys, like we get doll babies, you know, we get dishes, we get pots and pans when we're children. They make them pink, the stove, but the guys get fighting guys, and they're constantly battling and fighting on camera. And then you can, like, bend their arm up like Ultraman. And so this is how, you know, we have to be careful that we don't create these kinds of toy soldiers and take on these kinds of atmospheres. This comes from the lack of prajna. It is curious that prajna is considered or elucidated as the feminine principle, the feminine energy, wisdom, and that compassion is the male principle, the male energy. But we've just turned it completely upside down, and we think all of that compassion stuff, oh, that's that, you know, that all the soft, touchy, feely thingies, you know, and that's why they think that we should be seen and not heard. That's why they think that if a man is taking charge of a situation to set it right, that he's he's showing leadership and so forth. But if a woman, she's like out of her place, you know, things like that, you know, should be seen and not heard. Stay in the kitchen, give them pink dishes, and so it, our worldly wisdom is turned around, and so. But men have within that spark of it's a fierce kind of compassion. And women have that wisdom, but it's a gentle kind of far-seeing wisdom. And as we recorrect and allow the feminine voice to enter the dialogue, then we were seeing a shift in things. So it's not going to be long now before I think we're going to get rid of the great male-female dichotomy, you know, so I'll probably be the first one that ordains men. I'm working for that, just in case, you know, I get written off, y'all can carry on. But I'll be the one that goes first. I see a lot of changes. There's several temples now that have, within Theravada, that have male and female living together, you know, and me and Panyadipa started that. I mean, now they did come to check us out. Abbots from all over would come, you know, they were sure I was wrong. And but when they would meet deeper, you know, yeah, it was over. I mean, deeper's like, any questions? And they like have no questions. You know, he'd say, you're all right, you know. And so so there is some progress, but you have to be willing to stand alone to do it. And if you allow these stages to fully mature in your life, you will be able to. That's what the good news is. I like a scripture in the Bible says, when sin does abound, grace does much more abound. And grace is not like just heaping something on you that's undeserved. It means that it has been tried, it has been proven, it has been found worthy and comparable and able to take on and meet the challenge, you know, to meet the challenge that is before it and surmount it. It's like that. But we have to wait in that stage of overcoming final illusions, in that stage of allowing the signs to appear, in that stage of when the signs begin to appear, you have to be sitting, waiting on the signs. You have to recognize the signs. It's not just somebody telling you. I mean, Buddha Master told us to do certain things, but he didn't tell us how, he didn't tell us when, he didn't tell us, you know, we didn't even have all the why. You know, he said, because you can't understand it right now, so I'm not going to waste my breath. But as we start going through and doing our work, we start to understand the why. We start to understand the when or not yet. We start, and then we start to become imperturbable in allowing an unfoldment instead of creating something. You know, the whole, they have a term for people now who are making stuff. They call them creatives, you know, and I don't use the term because that that the there hasn't been enough loosening of the self. So that creative view of, and vision starts to be a little too myopic and in and internal instead of a, because of a non-emptiness, there can't be a vast outflow. So they think it's my song, I wrote it, my music, it's my, you know, and then it becomes something small, it becomes something diminutive, and the power that was present to free others becomes lost. There's one Dharma talk that I own. I've given some bad ones, but I've given some good ones, but I don't lay claim to any of them. The stage of the ninth stage is the stage of the all, the stage of the all-penetrating wisdom in which one preaches the law freely and without restriction. So I'm looking forward to that ninth stage, but I know that ninth stage doesn't come until after the eighth stage, right? So I should know, like, what stage I'm at. And I mean, to know, you can just ask. You know, mostly when we get an idea, we run off with it. We don't want to ask because we don't want we don't want the holy beings to say no or not yet or not this way, because I already have an idea of what I want to do and how I want to do it. I'm so excited about it. You know, from where I'm sitting, it's good, and it's not that it's not good. It's like, but Leah, that's good, but let me show you a more excellent way that will truly accomplish what you want, but you got to wait for it. And the 10th stage is the stage of the Dharma cloud, in which one benefits all sentient beings with the Dharma or the law, just as a cloud sends down rain impartially upon all things, or the sun shines impartially. And I said, I'm gonna shine on Paniwadi today. You know, it just shines without any notion of Paniwadi and any notion of shining. And yet it gives warmth to every being on the planet. Every being on the planet. And then one does without doing, and yet nothing goes undone. So we're coming into our spring season now. And sometimes in the winter, I'm in a summer season. Sometimes in the summer, I'm in a winter season. But it's nice to be aligning with the energy of the season. So things are just below the surface, getting ready to spring up through the earth, coming forward, but they will be tender sprouts. And we have to let them grow in their own time. Some will grow tall, some will grow short. Some will flower, some will bear fruit. Some will just provide cover or foliage, but all things beautiful in its time. And that's all we have to hope for. Not that this gets rectified, not that that happens, not that, you know, all of these little things, but just recognizing that all things are beautiful in their time. So I'm gonna end there. It's 1:11. I thank you for coming today. I was so tired, like last night after the retreat. Then we had four people who had empowerment, and I think that took like 2.5 or 3 hours. I sure didn't expect to see you this morning. I said, he's not gonna be able to get out of the bed. I'm like really shocked. And when I woke up, I like didn't wanna move either. And I knew today had 3 different events today. And I was like, I don't know how I'm gonna get through this, you know? And then I chided myself on that mind that's looking at what I can't do. Because I had just said to somebody, you know, your stuff will come back to you. I just said to somebody when we, you know, like made the desks and we made the skirts for the desk. And, you know, like I saw it that we should do it instead of just having the tables, make them kind of look like a classroom and desk. It would do something for, you know, like just raising the atmosphere for the training. And so it came to me to do it. And they were like, oh no, well, we can't do that. Oh, don't bother, it's fine, it's fine. It's like, no, it's not fine. We have to do it. And then it was the night before, you know, these last minute signals. One day I'm gonna start getting signals earlier, but but these last minute signals I get. And so we had run out, I gotta find the fabric, can't find enough fabric everywhere. The security guard wants to check my receipt. I've lost it from the time I got to the door. They got to go back and hunt in the computer for the receipt. 6 people go past and he only steps forward for me, and all I got is a things of fabric and plastic flowers, you know, and he wants to see my receipt. So, and then but I was nice because I'm preparing, you know, for this. I'm all nice, but no, I don't mind, you know. We get on, and it's taking a long time now. I do mind, you know, but I'm just going through it, being good. And then I handled it so nicely that he said, you know, I just appreciate your, you know, how you, because I'm sure he catches it at Walmart, you know, hassling people. And so he says, you were so kind and you were so patient. I just thank you for doing all of this. And then he turns to me to give me a gift. I didn't quite, he says, are you saved? And, and I said, yes, I am. Otherwise, somebody would have to be taking you down from the rafters right now. You know, and I said, I messed it all up, you see? I was fine. I was fine until that moment. And then the little creeper on my other shoulder spoke up. And that's how quickly I'm saying, that's what, you know, that's how quickly we can like fall, is what I'm saying to you. You know, just that quickly, you know. And then, like, so now it's done, you know, and so he's giving me, and he laughed when I said it and nodded, you know, and then he wished me grace in Jesus and all of that. And I said, yeah, but that last remark, he's probably thinking, she really does need Jesus, but you need to leave people alone. And that was it. So we came back and we made them. So that held me up a long time. And then we made the fabrics. But when we put them on, everybody, you know, saw it. So there are going to come times that we get an instruction to do something. And I won't say it's a test to see what your endurance is, or whether you only do things if it can work out in your time frame. You have to put a little more effort or hustle to it. Like, it's like, never mind, it's not that important. You know, but if something, if, you know, following through and offering your best. And when those signs and signals come, you know, the yielding to them is not to say what we can't do, but what we can do. And so I thought about that. It smacked me in the face this morning when my body was saying, and my mind was saying, you are so tired, you know, and then I voiced it and I said, I am so tired. Not to cancel that, you know. And as soon as I canceled it, I was able to give up. And I was like, I had to tamp down my energy on the call today because of that, you know. And so I'm saying, be careful how we speak. Be careful. These voices that speak in the head, these that come up, don't regurgitate them out your mouth. They may speak. Let them speak. You know, you don't have to answer them. You don't have to agree with them. You don't have to respond to them. You know, don't not hear them, because if not, they just turn down the volume and it becomes subliminal, you know. But at least they're speaking loudly enough now, no longer subliminal. So can you see that's progress already? It's no longer subliminal. They're roaring in your head now. And you hear their voice. It says, but when one knows the voice of the Dharma, they won't follow anything else. A strange voice, they will not follow. So keep on keeping on. That's called the 10 stages of development. And you can probably Google for it, but I will have a sheet for you if you want it.
Down in samsara, we got lots of suffering, greed, attachment, anger, and impermanence. Here's the truth, there's a whole nother way towards liberation and a peaceful state. On and on, we just keep on trying, and we smile and we feel like crying. Doubt will always weigh you down. We don't know that we have all that we need. Pick up the Dharma and see where it leads. On and on, we just keep on trying, and we smile and we feel like crying. Shoulders and our toes in the sand. Life is good when the Dharma's in hand. How did we miss it? Just don't cling and be free. Easier that way and less harm and deed. On and on, we just keep on trying, and we smile instead of crying. On and on. It just don't cling and be free. Easier that way and less harm indeed. On and on, we'll just keep on trying, and we smile instead of crying. On and on, 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 on and on.
no harm come to you, no danger. May you always be able to meet the inevitable difficulties of life.
Yeah. Yep.